Welcome to Crash News. Today is May 15th, 2025. Ever feel like you're just scrolling endlessly through news headlines, kind of drowning in it all? Especially with AI.
Oh, absolutely. It's moving so fast.
Exactly. So today, we're trying to cut through that noise. Think of this as your essential AI briefing. We're going to unpack the big stuff, explain what it means, why you should care.
Yeah, not just skimming the surface. We'll dive into the sources, connect the dots, make it clear and hopefully engaging.
We'll break down any tech terms along the way, too. By the end, you should have a really solid grasp of what's important right now.
And it's fascinating, the sheer pace of what's happening. Some really foundational shifts.
Okay, where should we start then?
Let's kick off with Google DeepMind's AlphaVolve.
AlphaVolve. Okay, sounds significant. What is it?
Well, basically, it's a coding agent. It's powered by Google's Gemini AI. But here's the key thing. It's not just suggesting, you know, little code fixes.
Ah, okay. So it's doing more.
Much more. Its main job is to iteratively generate and actually improve entire algorithm solutions.
Wow. So it's not just tweaking, it's building from the ground up, almost, like designing a whole new program.
Exactly. Think of it less like a code spell checker and more like an AI system architect.
Okay, that's a big claim. How does it actually do that?
Well, the process is pretty clever. AlphaVolve first proposes a full algorithm solution. Then it uses these automated evaluators, you can think of them as AI judges, basically to test how well the code performs, objectively.
Right, so it gets feedback.
Precisely. And based on those test results, AlphaVolve learns which approaches work best and then builds on them in the next round. It keeps refining, iterating, improving.
And this isn't just theoretical, is it? Like, is it being used?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's already having a real impact inside Google. If you look at their core infrastructure, they're seeing tangible benefits.
Like what?
We're talking about improvements in data center efficiency, you know, those huge places that use tons of power. Also, advances in designing their computer chips and even making the process of training other AI models more efficient.
Okay, those sound like fundamental improvements. Things that could save energy, boost performance across the board.
Exactly. That's the kind of foundational stuff we're talking about.
Now, I did see a number mentioned. Something about a 75% success rate on math problems. Mm. Why is that a big deal?
Yes. That 75% figure on quite complex math problems is really interesting. It shows AlphaVolve's ability to reason and problem solve at a pretty high level. It's not just recalling solutions it's seen before.
It's actually figuring things out.
It seems so. It shows it can independently discover effective strategies for new challenges. And what's maybe even more impressive is that in 20% of those successful cases, AlphaVolve actually found solutions that were better than the known best ones.
Better than human design solutions.
In some cases, yes. Improved upon them.
But I guess it has its limits, right? It's not about to write the next great novel or compose music.
Hey, no, you're right. That hits on a key limitation currently. AlphaVolve really shines on problems where the solution's success can be automatically and objectively measured. Think numerical problems, tasks with clear performance goals.
Okay.
It's less effective right now when dealing with things that are more subjective, you know, non-numerical issues where you need human judgment to say if it's good.
Right. Makes sense.
Yeah.
Powerful, but in specific areas.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's shift gears. Another big name, OpenAI. They've just put new GPT models into ChatGPT itself.
That's right. They announced GPT 4.1 and GPT 4.1 mini are now available directly within ChatGPT.
What are the main upgrades there? What's new?
Well, GPT 4.1 is faster, which makes using it feel smoother. It's also significantly better at programming tasks, which is a big plus for developers. And maybe the headline feature, it supports a 1 million token context window.
A million tokens. That sounds huge. Can you break that down? What does that mean practically?
Yeah, it's a massive amount. Think of a token as roughly a word or maybe a piece of code. So a million tokens means the AI can process and remember context from an enormous chunk of information, like the equivalent of a pretty hefty book or a very large code base all at once.
So it can handle much more complex tasks, keep track of longer conversations or documents.
Exactly. Deeper understanding, more coherent responses over long interactions. And this GPT 4.1, it's available for ChatGPT Plus, Pro, and Team subscribers.
Okay. And what about the mini version, GPT 4.1 mini?
Right. The mini is important because it's actually the new default model for all ChatGPT users now. That includes people on the free plan.
Oh, interesting. So everyone gets an upgrade.
Pretty much. It replaces the older GPT 4.0 mini. And OpenAI says both these new models perform better across the board compared to the previous versions.
It's interesting. They were API only first. Why add them to ChatGPT now? Was it user demand?
It really seems like user feedback played a big role. Putting these models directly into ChatGPT makes them accessible to way more people. While APIs are great for developers building specific things, this move caters to everyday users wanting better performance right in the chat interface they already use. It sort of democratizes access to the newer tech.
Makes total sense. Putting the power right there for everyone. Okay, let's switch domains again. Audio, Stability AI, and something called Stable Audio Open Small.
Yes, Stability AI has open sourced this model, Stable Audio Open Small.
Open sourced, meaning the code is out there for anyone.
Exactly. Free to use, modify, build upon. It's a text-to-audio model, so you give it text, it generates audio.
Like sound effects, music.
It can generate short audio clips, sound effects, maybe simple musical elements based on text descriptions. It's a relatively small model. Architecturally speaking, 341 million parameters.
Which sounds like a lot, but I guess it's small in the AI world.
Compared to the huge language models, yes, it's quite compact, but it's surprisingly efficient.
Efficient how? Like fast?
Yeah, very fast. It can apparently generate an 11-second audio clip on a regular smartphone in under 8 seconds.
On a phone? Wow.
Right. That kind of speed and ability to run locally on mobile devices really highlights its efficiency. It lowers the barrier for creating audio content quite a bit.
Very cool. Okay, moving from creation to safety, that's always a huge topic. OpenAI launched a public safety metrics hub.
Yes, and this is quite significant, I think. It's a step towards more transparency. The hub's purpose is to publicly track how OpenAI's models are performing on key safety benchmarks.
What kind of benchmarks are we talking about?
Things like measuring hallucinations, you know, when the AI just confidently makes things up.
Right, that's a big one.
Definitely. Also, how well the model refuses to generate harmful or inappropriate content. Its resistance to jailbreaking, which is people trying to trick it into bypassing safety rules.
Okay.
And also just its general ability to follow the instructions it's given accurately and safely.
So it's like a public dashboard for AI safety performance. Allows researchers, the public, everyone to see the progress.
Exactly. It provides a public record, allows for more scrutiny, and helps people understand the ongoing safety work. It's a positive move, I'd say.
Good to hear. Now, beyond those big headlines, it feels like there's just a constant flood of other AI news. Our sources mentioned a few interesting bits and pieces.
Yeah, the landscape is just incredibly busy. One area getting more focus is the broader societal impacts of AI, what people call second-order effects.
The indirect consequences.
Right. How AI is changing things in ways we didn't immediately expect. Also, seeing companies like Klarna, the finance tech firm, adjusting their AI strategy, that might hint at broader industry trends or challenges as companies figure out how to actually use AI effectively and profitably.
Interesting. What else?
Well, there was a meta-analysis mentioned looking at lots of studies suggesting ChatGPT can be quite effective in education, especially for problem-based learning, getting students engaged.
Okay, so potential in the classroom.
Seems like it. And then there's the practical engineering side, too.
Right, like building actual tools.
Exactly. Deploying smaller models like Gemini Nano directly onto phones to help fight scams in real time, that's a direct benefit for users.
Yeah, definitely useful.
Also, work on AI news tools to help us filter information and open source code editors like Void, which help the developer community itself innovate.
It really is everywhere. And there were some super quickfire announcements, too, just highlighting the speed.
Oh, yeah. Things like that huge $5+ billion AI partnership announced in Saudi Arabia shows massive global investment.
Wow.
Then discussions about risks with things like the model context protocol ongoing work on security and that stat from Microsoft. AI writing up to 30% of their code now.
30%. That's a lot. Shows how integrated it's becoming in actual development.
Absolutely. And then just the rapid pace stuff. Discounts on AI events. PayPal popping up in AI search results. Chatbots having glitches sometimes, reminding us it's still evolving. And of course, new models like GPT 4.1 constantly appearing. It never stops.
Okay. That's a lot on the development side. For listeners looking for something practical, maybe something they can use today, we found an interesting AI tutorial tip. It's about deciding what to watch. Tell us about this Pix tool.
Ah, Pix from Likewise. Yeah, this is a neat one. It's basically an AI tool designed purely for entertainment recommendations. Books, podcasts, TV shows, movies. It learns your tastes and suggests things you might like.
Okay, sounds useful. How do people access it? Is it an app?
You can use it on their website or sign up for email suggestions, but maybe the easiest way is just texting the word PIX, P-I-X, to the number 500550.
Texting. That's pretty simple.
Yeah, very accessible.
Could you give an example? Like, how would you ask it for something?
Sure. Let's say you want a scary movie, but you hate slasher films. You could text something like, "Send me some scary movies on Prime or Hulu. No slashers, please."
And it understands that.
Yeah.
The platforms, the no slashers part.
That's the idea. The AI is meant to parse those details, genre, platform, specific exclusions, and give you tailored recommendations based on what's available. And the best part, it's free, just designed to help with that what should I watch tonight problem.
Okay, I might actually try that one. Solves a common frustration.
We also, a quick list of some other new AI tools just popping up.
Yeah, just to give a flavor of the variety out there, there's one called IntelliSay that's focused on voice commands for productivity, another called WhisperFlow, designed to help you write faster, kind of integrating into your workflow.
Okay.
Then Greta, which aims to let people deploy full web applications quickly, even without deep coding skills.
Interesting. Democratizing development.
Potentially. There's also VidMe, which helps creators scale content on TikTok and Instagram using AI to generate stuff that looks like user-generated content.
Hmm, okay.
And lastly, WhisperLarge V3, a new version of OpenAI's transcription model, offering supposedly simple one-click transcription for long audio files. Could be great for researchers, journalists, anyone dealing with lots of recordings. Lots of tools emerging constantly. Okay, wrapping up our dive into the sources, there are also some broader findings and resources mentioned. What stood out?
A few things. For listeners wanting to go deeper technically, Stanford's CS229 course on building large language models was highlighted as a great resource.
Good tip.
Also, the observation that ChatGPT written posts are becoming really common on places like Reddit that raises, you know, interesting questions about online content and authenticity.
Yeah, how do we know it's human anymore?
Exactly. Then there was a note about job growth in big tech being kind of stagnant for the last 3 years that could signal shifts in the industry. And AI tools being tested to gauge public opinion on things. The example was Botox, but it shows AI moving into market research and sentiment analysis.
And any overarching trends or maybe concerns?
Well, the trend of AI getting baked into existing platforms continues, like YouTube planning to use Gemini for contextual ads and videos. That could really change online advertising.
Ads tailored by AI understanding the video content.
Precisely. Also, Microsoft testing a Hey Copilot, wake word for Windows 11, making AI assistance even more integrated into the basic computer experience.
Always listening.
Potentially, yes. And Perplexity partnering with PayPal for shopping within the chat interface, blurring the lines between search, AI, and e-commerce.
Right.
We already mentioned OpenAI's transparency hub for safety, which is positive. And new models keep coming, like Alibaba releasing a video generation model called 12.1 VACE. The progress in multimedia generation is just relentless.
Okay, so pulling this all together, what does this actually mean for you listening right now? We've covered a huge range today. AI designing algorithms, making audio.
Powering better chatbots, helping you pick a movie.
Right. The pace is just incredible, isn't it? And understanding these key pieces seems more and more crucial just to navigate, well, everything.
What's really striking is how interconnected it all is. Improvements in core AI research feed into practical tools, which then change how we work, how we get information, even how we entertain ourselves. It's weaving itself deeper into daily life.
Exactly. And that leads to the big question, doesn't it? As AI gets more integrated, everywhere from the hidden infrastructure to the apps on our phones, how do we make sure its development, its deployment, actually aligns with what we value as a society? With our goals?
It's a huge question. No easy answers.
Definitely something worth pondering as you see these new AI features pop up everywhere. It's not just about the cool new tech, but the deeper impact.
Yeah, maybe something for you to think about next time you use an AI tool. What's it doing for you? But also, how might it be subtly shaping things, your choices, the information you see?
Good point. Well, thanks for taking this deep dive with us today. Stay curious, keep learning. We really encourage that. And we'll catch you next time with more insights from the cutting edge. And hey, if you found this valuable, if you learned something, the best free way to support us is to rate, like, and subscribe on whatever platform you use. It really helps others find the show.
Yeah, and join the conversation. We have a growing Discord community. The link's usually in the show notes.
Absolutely. And for those who want to go even deeper and help us keep doing these deep dives, you might consider becoming a Patreon supporter.
We really see this as more than just news. It's about learning together in this rapidly changing field.
Couldn't agree more. Your support makes it possible. Thanks again for listening.